Good afternoon. So you do remember yesterday I just began to explain why we would like to add another term to another possibility of events to our model. And today I would like to show you what could change. And the sort of surprising phenomena we observe. And so you remember, so we have added some additional transfer, which is a frequency dependent transfer. And we introduce some function tau of xy. And that means that we will make a transfer from xy to xx. That's my notation. And so we wrote at the end of the talk, we wrote the form of the additional term in the semi-martingale decomposition, so of integral of f of x with respect to the mutation process nu k of dx. And so I will not write all the intermediary terms. They are always similar as we have done before. But we had a last term that we wrote as the integral from 0 to t, integral from k to k. And so we have some function, tau of xy minus tau of yx over the total mass nu k s 1 times f of x integrated with respect to nu k s of dx, nu k s of dy, ds. Okay? That was this term, and I am finished by saying that we will introduce the transfer flux alpha of xy, which is the difference between tau of xy minus tau of yx. And I explained yesterday that usually, biologically speaking, the transfer is almost never symmetric. And in fact, it's better to consider unilateral transfer. It is closer to biological assumption than symmetry. And so we already saw the example where if the thread space is some subspace. I think I continue to take my toy model with 0,4. So if it is a subset of R, we can take tau of xy, which will be tau, a parameter tau, and we will see the dependence in tau in the behavior of the evolutionary system times the indicator that x is greater than 1. Okay, so it's what we can call unilateral transfer. So that's an example. Okay, so of course we have this expression and we can do exactly what we did before. I mean, consider large population approximation, prove by similar arguments the law of the population processes nu k are uniformly tight and converge in law and in probability to the solution of a nonlinear PDE, which is written in the notes that I will not write on the blackboard. And we can prove the uniqueness of the PDE. And of course, in addition to the nonlinearity in the competition term, we will have an additional non-linearity in the transfer term. And so this integral differential equation is not so well understood, and particularly for the moment, there are no results on the long time behavior of this PDE. So it can be an open problem for people in PDE to study this equation. And there are some students of Cepide Miraimi in Toulouse who are working on this equation. But here I will focus on the point of view we developed concerning the TSS trait substitution sequence approach to see what could be the outcomes of the evolution. So I really choose the evolutionary point of view here. And so remember, to understand what happened, we began, so we assumed that the mutation probability is almost zero, and we began by studying a two-dimensional dynamical system where we compare just two populations with this dynamics. So instead to think about density for the limiting law of nu k, it's better to think nu k as the sum of two Dirac methods on x and y. And so in this case, the system, I will write what the system becomes. So it has it is analogous to the Lotka-Volterra system in the sense that it has the same structure, but there will be an additional term due to the transfer, okay? And remember, we remarked the transfer is just an exchange. It does not change the total mass of the system. And we have already seen, but here what we will see is that since we will be in the macroscopic approximation, the transfer will appear through such conduits, and the parameter which will play a role in this dynamical system is the transfer flux. Okay, it's the mean between both transfer effects. Okay. So I write the system, the dynamical system. So I repeat, if I assume that the mutation probability is zero, if nu k is zero, has only two traits in the support, we equip the two traits and we study the dynamics of the trait. And so you have two traits x and y, and we will have dn x over dt, which will be nx times, so we have so R of x, remember, it's a growth rate B of x minus D of x minus the competition term, C of x, n bar x minus C of x, y, n bar y plus alpha of x, y over, so it's a, remember, it's a frequency dependent here it will be replaced by nx plus ny. This was individual rates. So we have to multiply by ny, the total number of individual which can be transferred by x times ny. Okay. And for so I could use the backboard adjust my endpoint x. It's exactly when I was before Polytechnique, I was in Nanterre, in University Paris West Nanterre, and we had always a blackboard as that, and that was always helpful for indexes. And so we have an equivalent. Line for dynamics for y for the total the size of the subpopulation with trait y. So and I don't know why I put ny minus c of nx c of y ny plus, and here we will exchange the rates. We will exchange y and x, and that will give alpha of so tau is not symmetric, but alpha is. So here it's alpha. It's not symmetric, but if you change, you have just alpha of yx over the total mass ny times nx times ny. Okay. So the first step is to study the long time behavior of the system to eventually predict the different outcomes we can have when t tends to infinity. Remember that the study of the system in the trait substitution sequence assumptions, it plays a role to predict the outcome of the evolution. So we have to see how it behaves. And the first thing I remark, that's something I learned from mathematician Pierre Collet, is that there is in dimension two there is a simple theorem to prove that there are no cycles. And it's a Bendixson-Dulac theorem, and so Claire is laughing because she used it. And so we have to exhibit what we call a Dulac function, which is as follows. It's very useful for two-dimensional systems. So if I write here, this is a P of nx and y. So it's defined and Q of nx and y. And the two functions are defined on the square of the positive quadrant. Okay? And so a Dulac function is a function phi, so which is defined. It's a function phi of uv defined on the strict positive quadrant square, such that if you consider du of phi p plus du of phi q, it must have a constant sign on this set. Okay, it has to be. It's a function of uv, and it has to be non-zero on R plus. And the theorem of Bendixson-Dulac says that if there exists a Dulac function to the system, you don't have any cycle. Okay. And for all, so you can see it. So it could have, I could have invoked this theorem also for the Lotka-Volterra system, but it's so well known, the Lotka-Volterra system. But for all systems which have such sort of structure, the good Dulac function is phi of uv is equal to 1 over uv. So it's just computation, but you can prove that taking phi is equal to this quantity, P and Q defined by this expression. You can prove here that this quantity is exactly equal to minus C of Fx U. So it's just computation, and you do it. C of YY V over UV. And YY, sorry. And I remember that we took an assumption, the first one that for any x we had that, and the second one was for any x, y, it was more than zero. Okay? And so this quantity is always negative on the strict, the square of the strict quadrant, positive quadrant. Okay? Okay, so that's the first remark. Remark.
Should be the derivative with respect to V, the second one?
So, sorry?
Should the second one be the derivative with respect to V?
Yeah, yes, it's V. I certainly said V, but thank you. Okay. The second remark is that we can prove that on the boundary, the only equilibria are 0, 0, n bar x, we already introduced this notation, 0 and 0 n bar y are the equilibria on the boundary. And if we study, and there is also a function which will help to know to characterize the stability here, and in fact we can construct this function exactly as we did for the Lotka-Volterra system. And so imagine that you are close. I will show not here with my screen. So here, what we have in mind is that in the system, if x, so nx is here and ny is here, so if here you have n bar x, at the beginning you are close to n bar x. So you are, for example, here, you have a small perturbation with a few individuals with straight y. and you would like to know what happens. And so there is, we can see what does it mean for the dynamics of Y if we are at for the initial condition is very close from this one, okay? And so what we observe is that the growth rate in this case is R of Y minus C of YX N bar X. We already seen that. For the local system, it was just this quantity. And here, this is negligible. And here, if NY is negligible, the NX disappear. So you have alpha of YX, and that's all, okay? So there is a new function appearing here, which is SYX, which is F of YX, the inversion fitness function in the case without transfer plus the transfer flux. And so we already see, and this function will govern the stability or instability close to this point. And here we begin to see the trade-off we can see because F has a sign and alpha has a sign. And so we know that here allow Y to invade the resident population with threat X, we have to assume that this quantity is zero. But this quantity can be zero because both of terms are zero. This quantity can be positive because both of the terms are positive, or because the usual invasion fitness function is positive, or if this one is negative, if the alpha is really is sufficiently positive. Okay, so if this quantity is large enough and positive, you can imagine that some deleterious in the sense of the demography individual could invade the population. Okay, and that can happen. And now if we want to understand what happened inside for the system, in fact, it's easier here to, so I will not explain things, but to introduce the equivalent system for the total mass nxt plus nyt, and for p of t, which is the proportion of x over in the system. And then your system has the structure that dn over dt is equal to n times a certain function of np. And so saying at least that you can have zero as the extension of the population, and dp over dt, and that can enlighten you with respect to a genetic population genetics model, for example, that you have first p one minus p times a function of np. And so here, of course, you see that p and one minus p, which describes the proportion of individual with threat X in the population and the proportion of individual with threat Y in the population. So they are related to the equilibria at the boundary, okay? And so you make computation and you replace. And so if you are looking for other equilibria inside the domain, you make this both equation equal to zero. You replace N by the function of P here and put in F2. And you prove that this quantity as function of p is a polynomial of degree 2. Okay? So you are at most, that's related to a question you asked me concerning the number of equilibria. So for the Lotka-Volterra system, it's only one. But here, in this case, you have at most two equilibria inside the positive quadrant. Okay, but sometimes, so, and now what I will write more precisely is the case that we observe is to find an example where we have invasion implies fixation. If we take C, the competition kernel equal constant, then I will show you the, the diagram phases. Yes, it can.
It follows from this Dulac function, the dual of the Lyapunov stability theorem that says that under that condition they must converge to the boundary of almost every
initial. You can have both either instability or stability inside one of them. So because you, yes, with the Poincaré index, you can see which is a source and which is a... So I will show you the different phases. And so if you take C is equal to constant, so it so it's easy to work, but what we observe it, so we have a certain very simple function here. And also, so I can write it. If C is equal to constant, where is the arrow? Ah, yes, I will be. I will write it to. Yes, you will have dn over dt is equal to n times pry plus 1 minus prx minus cn. So it has a sort of a logistic structure. And dp over dt, it's equal to p 1 minus p. And here we have f of yx. Be careful, I see that, I saw that in the note I wrote, no, it's s, sorry, it's s of x. Y, and in the note you have to, it's a mistake, I wrote S of YX. And so here we have only, this function is zero only on the boundary, if P is equal to 0, 1, and you see that the sense of the, if P, the monotonicity of P depends on the sign of the fitness function. And here you are exactly in invasion implies fixation fitness. So the invasion fixation of Y is characterized by the size of the fitness. And in this case, if C is equal, if C is equal to a constant, it's easy to compute. We have seen that in this case, F was the difference on the two growth rates. So if C is equal to constant, S of y x is the difference between r of y minus r of x, and alpha is the difference between tau of y x, the transfer from x to y, minus tau of x y, the transfer from x to y. Okay. And then we see exactly the demographic part, demography here, and the transfer. And if you want, remember we computed the probability to see really have the invasion, and we compute the probability of invasion of Y in the resident population with threat X, and we wrote it was it is then the positive part now is of SYX, which is the new growth rate in a certain sense. Over, so without transfer, here we only had the birth rate. But here, what is the effective birth rate? It's, of course, you have B of Y, but you have also new individuals with threat Y arriving by transfer from individuals from threat X. And so you will have plus tau of YX. Okay? And so we have already seen that here that there is a trade-off which can change the sense of evolution, but moreover, you also have a difference in the denominator for this invasion probability. Okay, so I have to go to where we were. We already have seen that. Okay. Okay, so I show you the diagram phases, so that was because the question of... of Ramon, it was for the Lotka-Volterra system. So when you are either in a situation where you will, if X is the resident population, you will keep X with these called parameters. Here, Y will invade, and here you have the coexistence equilibrium. And here, if the two fitness are negative, you have an unstable point here in the quadrant, okay? and with stable equilibria. And so that's the picture you have for the Lotka-Volterra system. So it's well known. And if you add the transfer, so with this frequency-dependent form of the transfer rate, you have two additional pictures where you can observe two equilibria, two additional equilibria inside the domain. So here, this one is stable and this one is unstable. And here, this one is stable and this one is unstable. And I told you that we could generalize this this rate to some rate which take into account more or less density dependence or frequency dependence depending on the total population size. And for more general rate, you can add other diagram phases. I mean, this one is related to this specific form of the transfer. Okay? Okay. And now I would like to show you simulation to better understand this trade-off I explained. And so here we make simulation. So in case of what we call the costly plasmid, or in case, so in both cases you have unilateral transfer. So it's really, so here we have, in the first case, you see we have taken B of X, which is equal to one. So it's a resident population. So at the beginning, and here D is zero and C is constant equal to one. And so at the beginning, we have, so we know what is the equilibrium of this population. And we have seen that N bar X is R of X over C, so it's one. Time k times k, and so here the total population is around k, and a mutant arrives and the appear, and the mutant he has a birth rate which is only 0.5, but we have transfer unilateral transfer from x to y with rate 0.7, and what you see is that you have, because of this transfer, you can observe the invasion and fixation of this deleterious mutant in the population, okay? And that's due to this trade-off between the invasion fitness and the transfer. And here, so here the competition was constant, but here it's a situation where we assume in addition that the plasmid is costly in the sense that the competition between individuals carrying the plasmid is very high. And so it's four. For C, X, Y, it's one. And for the two other terms of the matrix C, it's two. And here, B of Y is 0.8, which is less than B of X, which stays equal to one. And here, what you see is that we can have, so here the matrix is not, so it's not constant, so you can allow coexistence, and here it's at what happens. You have coexistence between this very costly deleterious trait and the resident trait. Okay, so if you are transferred in the system, the outcomes of evolution are not so clear. And so that's the question we had in mind. So of course here, when we, after having computed all this, we can obtain an I let you read the theorem in the note, but you can obtain a theorem of convergence to a trait substitution sequence exactly as we did without transfer. Simply, the jump measure for this trait substitution sequence is related to this function where we have replaced F by capital S. And now I would like to show you simulation on an example. And to see what happened. So, as previously, we consider our toy model with key is equal to 0.4. B of x is equal to 4 minus x. I think I take d of x is equal to 1. And I take tau of xy, which is equal to tau 1 of x larger than y, and C is constant. okay? And so we have computed in this case this, so we have to compute, we can compute more explicitly what is the fitness. So it's R of Y. So R of X is 3 minus X. And so that will give you X minus Y. And plus, you have to take alpha of YX. So that will be tau of YX. So it's tau indicator of Y larger than X minus tau indicator X larger than Y. Okay? So finally, it's X minus Y. So it's tau if Y is larger than X and minus tau if X is larger than tau. So it's tau sine of Y minus X. Okay? So now we will work with this fitness function. And from the sign of this fitness function, we will deduce the possible outcomes for evolution, okay? So we have to, first, when tau is equal to zero, we all have already seen that, but I would like to recall that if tau is equal to zero, S of YX is positive if and only if, so X is larger than Y, and that means that a mutant will invade if it is less than the resident threat. And so we can imagine that evolution will lead to smaller and smaller threats. Until we can hope the optimal threat, which is zero, okay? The optimal threat for the demography is zero. I forgot to mention that we have mutation, so I think I wrote on the simulation. So it's here, yes. The mutation here, probability is a Gaussian law centered on X with variance sigma squared. And P is the probability of mutation is 0.03. And we consider K is equal in the simulation, K is equal to 1,000. And so at the beginning, so we take 1,000 individuals with threat 1. So that means if at the equilibrium, if the population is monomorphic with threat 1, so the equilibrium, the size, is 1,000 times n bar 1, which is 1,000 r of 1 over c, okay? And c, it's equal to 0.5. Yes, I remember, okay? C is 0.5. And so that gives you 4,000. So, and if you assume that evolution should go to zero, you should imagine that the evolution would lead to a population size which could be equal to 6,000. And so we make the individual-based simulations in this case. And what you observe, it's you see, so at the beginning, all the individuals have the threat 1. But by mutation and selection, so here we don't have any transfer. But by mutation selection, you will select the mutant which has less than one, more than upper than one, because the growth rate is better, and along over time, you will select individual with trait closer and closer to zero. So here you have the time, here you have the trait, here you have the mean trait, you see exactly the decreasing of this mean trait, here you have the histogram at this time, so it's really peaked at zero, of course you have some cloud or near zero, but it's really peaked at zero. And here you have the size. So you see that very fast you go to 4,000, it's here. And then when the threat go to zero, you have exactly here, you have 6,000. So we understand very well this picture, okay? Now we can see what happens when t is non-zero. And so we have to study when s of yx is positive. So first case, we can have either x larger than y. So if x is larger than y, y minus x is negative. And so the fitness in this case is x minus y minus 2. Okay? So here you will have it's positive if tau is less than x minus y. So what you see is that if tau is small, then y will invade the population if y is less than x. So for tau small, we could see some picture which is close to the one with tau equals 0. But you can have another situation where y minus x is positive, and then in this case, you will have x minus y plus tau positive, meaning that tau is larger than y minus x. And this situation is new. And what you can see is that for large tau, evolution can lead to larger traits. And we can imagine that it could be so large that the growth rate is negative and that the population go to extinction. We can imagine that it could go to what is called extinction. And in ecology, in eco-evolution, it's called evolutionary suicide by transfer. That was the question the biologist had. Okay, so now we observe simulation in these cases. So here I have tau is equal to 0.2, and we have almost no modification with respect to the first picture without tau. But it takes a lot of time, but you have essentially the same form. You will wait a larger time to attain a small neighborhood of zero. But we see the decreasing of the mean rate and the equilibrium also on the population side. Okay, so now we see another value, a large value of tau, and here we have also what we were waiting for. That means that the transfer is so strong that from the trait one, immediately when individuals appear, they are transferred by the larger one, and so you see that evolution makes traits go larger and larger. And of course, here we have 3. So remember, at 3, the growth rate becomes negative. And we see the mean trait, which is increasing. But at the same time, the population size is decreasing. Okay, and this population goes to extinction. And of course, we ask what happens inside. And we made simulation for tau is equal to 0.6. And what we obtained that, which was a big surprise. And so you see that the transfer is large. So at the beginning, it is exactly at for tau is equal to 1. But at some point, so you see in the same time that here we have the mean trait, but here we have the population size. You see when the trait is increasing and you have the exact form with the form n bar x in function of f, you have the decreasing of the population size until some moment where there exist only a few individuals in the population. And so the transfer becomes smooth because there are so few individuals. And then if you keep in the population some individuals which are best adapted, which are better adapted, say, and they can develop a new strain. Okay? And so we observe this sort of cyclic behavior in this population. And for tau is equal to 0.7. So I show you how it is delicate because we have 4 simulations with the same parameter. And so here we see 2 situations where we have a sort of, it seems that we have a cyclic phenomenon, even periodic, and we will, I will show you in an example that we can obtain effectively such sort of behavior. And but if, and of course, this jump here, you have the end of this strain and the reemergence of your new strains, but this distance here is very, very large with respect to all the parameters. It cannot be due to a mutation, for example, not at all. It's really the new strain emerges because it remains a few individuals here. And we will see the lineages in the next slide to see that. But here, certainly, so here, it certainly remains individuals here, but they are not so well adapted. So finally, it goes to extinction. And here, there certainly, all the population has been transferred. So that depends on what happens at the beginning. But so to explain what I was saying here, some students, they reconstruct. So it's not the same student. So zero is here now. But you have, perhaps, I'm not sure you see, but we see these strains here. They are not so visible. But here, the aim was to take all the individuals alive at a certain time and to see what were their lineages. And we see that the lineages, that means the trait history of this individual. And you see that even, so remember the macroscopic view is this one. But if you consider this distribution at time t, and you reconstruct the history of individuals, you see that they are all related, zero is here. So they are related to individuals with small traits, okay? Here we have one, so it's not exactly the same scale. But so reemergence is really due to the few individuals which were able to survive, even if we have a competition and transfer, which could have killed or transferred them. Okay?
Could you come back to your previous slide?
Yeah. There are a few points. Yeah. No, here we don't see anything, but we, in fact, in the simulation, we see that there remain some points. Yes. So, of course, we were very excited because we thought it could explain the reemergence of resistance strains, for example, or something like that. Because, okay, so. Of course, we are very interested, and our aim now is to capture such sort of behavior and to understand why we could obtain some such sort of cyclicity or periodicity in the system. Okay?
Just to understand correctly, you do not see it in the differential equation.
No. So it's purely stochastic. It's really we simulated the individual Bayes model. No. But it was just to understand that there is this trade-off that I we need to. But so now, effectively, to try to understand something in this picture, we will consider a very simple stochastic model. And but of course, we so that what is exciting in such sort of question is that we always consider large population approximation. But we really need to keep track of the information of a few number of individuals. Okay. Okay. So of course, if we come back here, because you could say yes, but you spoke about trait substitution sequence, but we need to have a separation of timescales to do that. And here, if we consider Kp. Kp is not at all negligible. And remember, for this trait substitution sequence, we needed to have Kpk tend to zero. So here you have P is small, but Kpk is not small. Kp is not small. And secondly, we can observe, so we have to change our mind for that. And here we can observe, but you don't observe certainly, that the time between two reemergences is short. So this long time scale, 1 over Kpk, is too long. And so here we will change our match, which will be closer to the one we had yesterday, but it's not exactly the same point of view. Which will be to say, so K will be large, and we have to keep information on small subpopulation, finite number of individuals, we don't know how to do, but we are able, we have seen that yesterday, to keep information for subpopulation with size K to the alpha, K to the beta, I'm not a beta, for a small beta. I mean, we can imagine that beta is less than 1. And here we have competition. We will keep competition. And remember, the competition, it's not the same situation as yesterday. I mean, the competition regularizes the population and makes the population staying of order K. Okay? So remember that, in fact, but we need that. If you consider the competition kernel from an individual with trait Y over an individual with trait X, it's multiplied by the number of individuals with trait Y over K. That's why we took as assumption from the beginning. So that means it's renormalized by K. That means that we only see the competition by subpopulation whose size is of order K. Okay. So our aim now is to see some models on which we could observe this reemergence and eventually understand what happens. And to do that, as I said, we wanted to observe such a subpopulation. And to simplify, so we were partly inspired by a paper by Durrett and Maybury, which is in a simpler situation, but never mind. And exactly in parallel with us, for completely different ecological questions, there is a very close paper by Bovier, Cookies, Maddy. They were interested in capturing fitness of what is called fitness valley in ecology. So it was another problem, but they use similar arguments, Maddy. 2000. Okay. So the idea is to consider this toy model, but to see something. So we would like to focus on this part of the picture. That means to consider that zero is the optimal trait, and to just consider mutation which go from zero to a larger trait. Okay, to simplify as best as possible the model. And we will discretize it. So as yesterday, we will discretize. And so, but here we take a fixed mesh, okay? And for the moment, it's the only thing we are able to do. And so we consider our set is I delta, our trait space is I delta for I between 0, 1, or we assume that 1 over delta is an integer to simplify 4 over delta minus 1, okay? And n I kt is as yesterday the number of individuals with trait I delta. So we have a vector of it's really simpler since instead of a measure valued population process, we have a vector valued population process. Okay. And so the dynamics. So I have to describe the mutation. So I continue to keep this quantity. So I have a constant. So I keep my fitness. And so I have to describe the mutation part. So T of X is equal to 1. And I assume that PK is equal to K minus alpha with alpha between 0 and 1, strictly. And then pk tends to zero, but kpk tends to infinity. Okay. So that's another time, mutation timescale. Okay, and when I have a mutation, I assume, so it's very simple, it's really to simplify the mutation effect. I assume that the mutation will derive from an ancestor X that will give an offspring with trait X plus delta. So we jump, we just jump from one compartment to another one, and on the right, since delta is positive, and it's always on the right, just to simplify. And our aim is to, so we are looking for the subpopulation by of the form, so our aim is, as yesterday, to find the subpopulation, so to hope that the order of the subpopulation size is of the form k to z beta, and then we will study the process of logarithm of, so here the subpopulation can go to zero, so I keep one to be sure that it's well defined, n y k of t, and so exactly as yesterday, we have seen that for if you have no mutation, if you have only birth and death, we know that we attain, if the initial condition is of this order, we will stay in this order at the time scale logarithm of k. Okay, and so we will consider this process over logarithm of k. And we would like to understand the dynamics of these processes for I between 0 and for over delta minus 1. Okay, and so for as initial condition, I take, so we said that we consider that 0, the first, is at equilibrium. And so what could I write the initial condition here? So the equilibrium at zero is integer part of 3k over c. And since we are at the scale logarithm of k, so we will see later on some lemmas, but immediately the mutation have an effect. And so we can assume that we have already the effect of mutation from this quantity on the other compartment. That means that we will have, so it's of order k, so pk is k minus alpha, so here we can have k minus alpha, k minus 1 minus 2 alpha, etc., until the last term for which L, for which 1 minus L alpha is positive, and then you have 0. Okay? So that's the initial condition. Okay. So to understand what happened, we have to observe, to decorticate. It's a good term in English. No, I don't know. How do you say when you eat a crab, for example? You don't eat a crab. Sorry?
Deconstruct.
So deconstruct, yes. I'm not sure it's exactly the same word, but. So I rewrite the fitness. Okay. So the first remark, we can have is that if we have a small population with trait Y in a resident population with trait X, it's always the same ideas, but such that with Y is less than X, so that gives approximately a birth and death branching process or birth and death process with birth which will be 4 minus y, and with this, which will be 1 plus we have the competition term times the population, the number of individuals with threat x over k, plus a transfer, because remember the transfer is unilateral and x is stronger than y. So the transfer happened from y to x. That means that from the point of view of y, it's a death term. Okay? And so we have a first lemma. We have to prove. So we would like to prove some convergence of this process, but uniformly in time, and at least in probability. And so here we already need a lemma in this situation, very simple. And so the first lemma we were obliged to prove is that if you consider, say, a linear birth and death process, so a binary branching process, BD process. So we birth rate B, death rate D issued from essentially K to the beta. Well, so it's not exactly an integer. So K to the beta minus 1. If we want an integer part of K beta minus 1, it's a good. Well, essentially, it's K beta, which should be our assumption in this. In this context, then, and so we assume, remember, that beta is less than 1, less or equal to 1. And then, in this case, we can prove that, it's not surprising, but it's not so easy to prove, then the logarithm of 1 plus, I call it zk, zk taken at t logarithm of k over logarithm of k converges in probability uniformly in t less than capital T when k tends to infinity to a continuous function which is either, so it's not surprising, beta plus B minus D T supremum zero and for T less than capital T. So it's here, it's the process, it's this process for T less than capital T. Okay? We have this lemma. So I would like to prove it because I think that the proof is interesting by itself. And I know that it has already been used in different situations. And so that's the case where y, the mutant, is less than x. Because, of course, you have a mutant, you have different compartments, and you have to compare a mutant with the upper compartment and the lower compartment. So here we compare it with the upper compartment. I will keep my initial condition. And so now we have the same question, but... yes, I could add that here we are not surprised. So, of course, we will have a proof depending on the sign of B minus D. I didn't precise the sign if this sub was supercritical here. But we can prove in addition that if B is less than D, so if beta is large at the beginning, it can be positive. Okay? And until a certain time. But what we can prove that for... T greater than beta over, so I write R is equal to B minus D, so greater than beta over, since R is negative, I take the absolute value of R. Then the limit when k tends to infinity of the probability that zk in t logarithm of k is equal to zero, this one, is equal to 1. That's that means that in this scale, this gives the scale of the extinction time. Okay. Okay, so second, that was the first point. So now we can consider a small population with straight Y. So in a resident population with straight X. But now we assume that Y is X plus delta. It's a mutant of X. Okay. And so now what we have, so it's larger than X. Huh? Okay. And so now the birth rate for the population is 4. So you have always 4 minus Y. But here you can have transfer from X to Y. So you have plus tau here. And you have death, which is only 1 plus nx over k, capital C. But you can also receive some individual y by mutation. Okay, so mutation from the compartment of individual with straight x. And individual y can also, so ny, receive the contribution from X due to mutation. But if we know that the population at time X is of the form K to something, so NX times, and we have, we will see that the mutation effect, so it's K minus alpha. And so we can, so individual mutation effect, probability of mutation is k to two minus alpha. Okay, so the contribution is as this form, and so at the time scale, if you consider the time scale t logarithm of k, it's as earlier, you have here, if you assume that this is true, you have some quantity which is of the form k. So I take the same notation, kc plus some 80. Okay. And so we have to consider, so if you, we consider this structure, we have a linear birth and death process plus immigration. And we have to see what happened for the exponents in this case. So that was the hard dilemma, because we have to consider so many cases. It's difficult, but and so I give you the result. So you see that there will be a sort of effect, you have two effects, the effect of the demography and the effect of the mutation from the compartment just per you. Okay, so I am obliged to erase here. And oh, it's too bad. I would like to keep my two lemmas. So this is one is here. So the lemma 2, I will write to the fitness later. So now, so I have the same assumption as lemma 1. BD beta. Plus immigration. At rate k c exponential to the 80. So we will have k to the 80 because we are at the scale t logarithm of k. Okay. And then in this case, so I give you two cases. There are other cases in the node, but essentially the two main cases. If we assume so that cases which will be related to our situation. C is less than beta, so beta is initial, the order of the initial condition. And beta is positive. Then in this case, the logarithm, so it's always the same process. 1 plus zk of t logarithm of k over log k for t less than capital T. It stands, it's always in probability with an uniformly for t less than capital T to something which is beta plus b minus dt, supremum with c plus at, supremum zero. And that's a function for t less than t. Okay? And the second case, which is interesting, in the case where beta equal zero, always with c less than beta, so that's beta different zero, beta equal zero. And then in this case, the convergence is to b minus d supremum a. A is this quantity, this parameter, times t minus a, c over absolute value of c, since c is negative, since I have always this assumption, c less than beta. So c comes from the mutations that you arrive for inside, and c over a. Supremum zero. We keep this, okay? And it's always t less than t. So we will make some picture to understand how it can work and what can happen. So we have different situations. And you see, you at any time you have to take the supremum between two trajectories, two linear. So we will obtain some affine, some piecewise affine functions. And so a first case, for example, so it's to take zero, so c is less than beta and positive, zero less c than beta. And imagine that you have two slopes, that, for example, you have this slope for and this slope. So this one, is you have that the growth rate is negative and a is also negative, but you have that b minus d is less than a, less than zero. And you take the supremum. That means that at the beginning, your exponent will be driven by this quantity until it attains this point. And there, it will be driven by this quantity, and then zero. Okay, so that's simple. But you can have different other picture. For example, you can imagine that you have beta positive and c negative. I don't write where is c. C would be somewhere, for example, here. Beta is here. And you also have some decreasing of this going to zero. And you have mutation arrive from here, for example, with this slope. Okay? So here it's c. And so here you have the effect of mutation. So here that means that b minus d is negative and a is positive. Okay? And in this case, you see that it seems so beta is decreasing. So it seems that you are extinct. But in fact, because of the mutations, you will be the compartment will be. There will be individuals arriving, and meaning that your exponent it's increasing. Okay, and you can also so you can have different situations. So we can see a situation where we have this other situation. So we can play with the parameters, but you see that it has to be observed carefully. That so at the beginning we have beta is equal to zero. So you have here, and you have a C, which is here, for example. And we assume that zero is, so I write here, zero is less than A, less than B minus D. So here, B minus D would be positive, but at the beginning, you don't see the individuals. But you have mutation, And the mutation will create some individuals. So here we have the line C plus 80, which is like that. And here it's the point absolute value of C over A. Okay? And so from here it begins, and you see that you take the supremum between A and B minus D. But here in this situation, I assume that B minus D is greater than D. So that means that you have from here, you have another line. Here it's C plus 80. And here it's B minus D times T minus the absolute value of C over A. And of course, you go until the regulation is at one. If you have one, your trait is now the resident trait. Okay. So you have different pictures, and so we have to take into account all this such sort of events. Okay. So.
So all these pictures you can find in the.
In the model, in the model. Yes, but we wanted to explain this reemergence and what could happen. So, yes, it's to show the richness of model which can appear from these biological questions. But of course, it's more mathematical than. I think it's interesting by itself to consider this question. But. Okay, so either I just show you the form of the limit, or I prove the lemma one, which I think it's interesting. It stays 15 minutes. I could show you an example to be motivated for tomorrow.
Could you comment on the fact that there it disappears, and in the other two examples, it just increases? What makes the difference between
No, it's just difference between the value of the coefficients.
Yeah, but is there a reason?
There are no reason, but depending on the dynamics, you can observe all these possibilities. Okay. So let's see on the example, perhaps. I suggest to come back to this tomorrow. And I show you for so we develop an example which is the only one we understand almost perfectly, which is the case with three traits. And so we assume that we have zero, delta, two delta, and that's all. And so that's related, of course, to assumption on the value of delta, because you have to stay in 0,4. And the interesting case is where tau is greater than delta. Not you have no problem. So, example with three traits. And so we take delta less than tau, less than two delta, less than three. And a fortiori less than 4. Okay? And you have zero. So the three traits, they are zero, delta, two delta. And we assume at the beginning that the resident population is zero. Okay? So at the beginning, so we consider the dynamics of the exponent. We try to understand what happens. And so at the beginning, we have zero, and we said that it was one minus alpha. So we assume that alpha is less than over 2 to have 1 minus 2 alpha. If not, it would be 0. Okay? And so the B minus D of the lemma is the fitness, the growth rate. So for us, it's the fitness. So here it's 0, it's delta, 2 delta. Okay? That's the corresponding trait. And here they are the exponent of the initial condition, the beta. Okay? So at time 0, so that's time 0. Okay, so now so we know that the population with trait 0 is resident. So at the beginning, we only have for 0, so we have the trait 0. in the picture, the delta are like that. So I prefer to do the picture. It's not okay. It's in Vincent. So we have the resident. It's one until it is not one. So we will see when. So now we consider the trait delta. And so we consider the subpopulation with trait delta. And so it receives, so it has its own dynamics due to its fitness in the resident population with trait zero, plus a mutant arriving from zero. And we have seen that we have to compare the exponent due to the demography, due to its fitness, and the part due to the mutant part. So it's easy because you have to compare the two slopes. Okay? Okay, so the fitness of delta, so I have to rewrite the fitness. In the resident population with trait zero, so you have just I, so it's zero minus delta plus tau. So it's tau minus delta, which is positive. Okay? And the initial condition is 1 minus alpha. So a candidate, the first part of the lemma 2, the demographic part, is 1 minus alpha. So beta 1t, the limit, should be 1 minus alpha plus tau minus delta t. And what is the contribution for by mutation from trait 0? Since you have a population of order k, the individual mutation probability is k to the minus alpha, so the contribution is k to the 1 minus alpha. And so it's this quantity is larger since tau minus delta is positive. So we have the first candidate, the limiting exponent from this quantity. Okay. Now we consider S2 trait 2 delta. So if we compute the fitness, F2 delta 0, we have minus 2 delta plus the sign plus tau plus tau, the sign of 2 delta minus 0. And tau minus 2 delta is negative. Okay. So the demography. The term which corresponds to the demography, the initial condition for the trait 2 delta is was minus 2 alpha. So you have 1 minus 2 alpha plus, so I should write minus to be clear that it is, okay, 2 delta minus tau. This one is positive t, okay? It's decreasing in t. But you have to consider the mutation. And the mutation which arrives in the compartment 2 delta are due to the compartment delta, and you have to add the exponent of the population size, you have to multiply it by minus alpha. It corresponds to the k to the minus alpha. And so that gives you 1 minus 2 alpha plus 2 minus delta. And this one is positive. Okay? So you have to take the supremum between that and 1 minus 2 alpha plus minus delta, okay? And so this one is a good one, and this one is beta 2 of t. And so that means that they have the same slope, and so you see that, I will do my picture, and after that I will show you, I'm not sure it will work. So at the beginning, you have beta, which is zero delta to delta. You have this one, which is one, and you have a certain slope and a parallel slope from two delta. Okay? It's like that. It works? Thank you. Okay. So it's the first simulation. So here the trait has 0, 1.2, and 2.6. Okay? And so this one is outside here. So we have that. And so alpha is equal 1.3, delta, sorry. Alpha is 0.32, and tau is 1.5. And so you see that you have the exponent of the thread, the resident population thread 0, the slope corresponding to the exponent of the population with thread y, and the slope for the subpopulation with thread 2 delta. Okay? And of course, you can do that until you arrive here. And here, what happens? So you have the both exponents are equal to 1. Okay? And so you can compute. You have to take that is equal to 1. So this point is alpha over tau minus delta. The time here is alpha tau minus delta. And in this case, both threads seem coexist at the macroscopic size. But you know, since we have taken that C is constant, that you have an invasion implied fixation theorem. So you cannot have this situation with two resident threads. So we have to compute, but we know it, of course, already, but the fitness of zero in a resident population with thread delta. So either you take the inverse of that, or you recompute the situation, but yeah, you can prove that it's negative. So that means that from this point, the exponent of the population with thread zero will decrease, okay? And it will decrease, so for the thread zero, at the beginning, you have, so I will call this quantity S1. At the beginning, it's 1, the exponent is 1, so the dynamics should be 1 minus, so this quantity is minus tau minus delta time t minus S1, okay? And 0 does not receive mutation, okay, since the mutation go up, so it's all, that's all for 0. So we have the new dynamics of the thread zero, which is decreasing with this. Okay, so this one, so that's why we take a different color. This one begin to increase, and this one is a new resident. Okay, I should take a red. That was already ideas in the paper by Durrett and Maybury. But they didn't have transfers, they only had mutations, so it was really simpler. And this one, so we have to compute this one, okay? The thread, so the thread delta is 1. And the thread 2 delta. Now, since delta is the new resident thread, we have to compute S of 2 delta in a resident population with thread delta, okay? And so we compute. So it's equal to minus delta plus tau, the sign, which is positive, okay? And tau minus delta is positive. And the thread to delta, we have to compute it at the time S1. And if you compute, you find that beta 2 of S1 is equal to 1 minus alpha, okay? And so for beta 2, it seems that you can find the same line. That means to continue your trip. Because if you consider the mutation from thread delta, they are only in k to the 1 minus alpha. So it's 1 minus alpha. And since here you have the slope continue to be similar. So for thread 2 delta, so it's also a blue. I could take, I don't know, what is this? Green. I give here I continue the life, and you see that you continue until you attain 1. So I should stop. And during this time, this one decreases. So I stop here to explain, but we can continue. And the simulation is perfectly adapted. So you have the second part, exactly the picture I made here, where you have this decreasing. And I continue to make computation. So I compute the time here, etc., etc. And so you have, here you can compute. And you see that here S2 is 2 alpha over tau minus delta. It could be a sort of iterative, unappealing it is not, but iterative way to compute this point. And here you see that at this point, so the thread 2 delta becomes resident, the thread delta is decreasing, and the thread 0 is increasing, okay? and you continue. And so we continue. So we made computation, and at some point, so after 5 steps, you see here, you have this picture, and I come back to the second step, and you see that you have exactly the same picture. So for this choice of traits, that explains the periodicity, okay? Just by this this play between all this fitness and the computation. And so that's a specific case where, for which we found a sort of periodicity, allowing to understand at least something. But of course, you can change the value of traits. And for example, you can, so here again, so you have the trait now is delta 1.1 and tau is 1.3. And so you have zero. You have the trait 0, which is a green one, 1.1, which should be this one. And you have 2.2, which is red, and another one, which is here, which is 3.3. And you see that this trait, it can survive, so you can see this population, but it never attains the level of residence. So we call such trait it can be, and it can also exist in situations where you don't have any resident traits. That means you can have situations where you have traits which are dominant, but with a population size which is less than k mean. So they don't appear in the competition, and so you have to introduce another fitness. That's why in the notes you have two fitnesses, S, the main one, and S hat for such sort of non-resident subpopulation. But you can, so here again, you have a sort of periodicity. Enfin, you have periodicity. But you can also have for more, here you have a lot of traits. And that's a funny situation where you see you have one trait, it becomes resident, and then it goes down until existent. Another trait, we become resident, and then it goes to extinction. And then you have a sort of, you have different tentatives, but they all go to extinction. This seems very. You see, in this situation, in this case here, yeah, exactly what I explained. You lose resident population. You have this population which is dominant, but its exponent is really strictly less than one. And you can obtain also situation like that, where it seems to be really awful. And so.
So when you say the exponent is less than one for everyone,
it's in the
deterministic dynamical system,
you just have zero. Yes. Yes, in the deterministic system, mm-hmm. you don't see anything because you are at the order k.
Yeah.
Here we are. We really want to capture a small subpopulation.
So exactly.
So we are not at all in the same asymptotics. Yeah. Mm-hmm. No, you're right. Okay. Mm-hmm. And so I will write the theorem. I am finished the theorem tomorrow. But essentially, we can prove that it converges to. You see, we have an idea of the limiting exponent, and they are piecewise affine, continuous in time t, and the slope in the definition are defined by the fitness function, in fact. But of course. You know that what is difficult is to know when you change your slope, and you have different ways to change the slope. Either you attain one and you become resident, or you attain zero and you become you have extinction, usually. And or you can change your slope, as I show you in the picture, by just the arrival of mutants from other compartments. Okay. I killed you.
So essentially, when you have only two traits, this regression is there is no specific behavior, if I understood well.
Yes, yes, two traits is not
but
so.
With three traits.
Yes, because since, especially in this model, we have no mutation. If you want to take two traits, at least you should have mutation in both sense, both direction. Because here we fix the direction of mutation. We go on the right systematically. Mm-hmm. to share the difficulties. No, because normally you can, in the main problem, you can go up, but you can go down too. So
I guess there is nothing particular about the form, like 4 minus delta that No,
just we discretize the space to be able to simplify the mutation.
Your B of X had a particular form.
But here it's 4 minus X,
yes,
you know.
There's nothing particular about it.
But it's linear in X, so here the fitness is very simple. So, but no. In the general case, just have to compute the fitness values to see and to compare them with the mutations. Well, I'm finished for today.